allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have a report on executive closed session.
We just need to go back to the roll call.
Where's... not on my agenda.
It's on item four.
Oh, and roll call.
Commissioner Doss?
Here.
Commissioner Dale?
Here.
President Coleman?
Here.
Commissioner Marks?
Here.
And Commissioner Higgins?
Present.
That's our job to give you a hard time.
Well, thank you, I deserve it. And now may we have a report on executive closed session?
Yeah, the board met on all items as agendized with Commissioner Dale recusing himself from item G. No reportable actions tonight.
All right, thank you. And now we will move on to public comment. This portion of the agenda allows the public to speak to the board on various issues not itemized on this agenda.
Evening, Todd Ranky, Woodley Island Marina. We have a... this is a privilege to be able to stand up here and pound our fist and voice our opinions, right, wrong, or indifference, and we all get to do that. That's a wonderful thing about this. And with that privilege comes a responsibility when there is great things that have happened, and we need to stand up and say that as well. And I want to take a minute as a resident of Woodley Island to let the staff know that there is a huge difference in what's been going on lately. I mean, it is visible when we drive in, we see it. You know, it's turning back into a, not that it never was a joyful place to be, but the maintenance has picked up. It's starting to look like we care, and my compliments to the staff and their crews that do it on a daily basis and keep fighting the battle, and you guys that put up with all of our garbage endlessly, and we thank you and appreciate what y'all do for us as residents. Thank you.
Thank you, Todd.
Yeah.
Vivian Hillowell, good evening. I just noticed that item G is missing on the printed agenda here. I noticed it on the online agenda. It's not on my, it's not on page two on my, yeah. I have a different one I got here. But you said Greg Dale recused himself from item G, and I'm looking for it, that's all.
It's not in there.
So I'd noticed there was something about a lawsuit with Pack Choice, and I thought you guys were all working together, so I'm curious about it, and I know you can't talk about it. But it's on the online agenda. Not on the paper.
Must have been a typographical error. Formatting error. Okay, if there's no other public comment, we will move on to the consent calendar.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
First, I'd like to ask if there's any items that want to be discussed on the consent calendar. They need to be moved to be pulled from the consent calendar. Otherwise, we'll take a motion to pass everything in the hall.
We do.
We don't need comment on the consent calendar, correct? So, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. Moving on to item nine, communications and reports, executive director's report.
The only thing I want to just say is that with the Nordic Aqua Farms project on our Redwood Marine Terminal 2 project, they submitted the the pre-application materials to the county planning department. And this last week, in this room, they sent out referrals to 20 some agencies. I don't know exactly how many of the agencies showed up, but there's 30 or 40 people here from the agencies reviewing that project. We went over in detail, and they laid out the timeline and basically were outlining what some of the agencies' concerns were on the project, so that those can be addressed within the application when they submit it for the final submittal, which they anticipate submitting in July. They kind of outlined the construction or the planning period that they thought that it was going to take the county to go through, which is approximately in the spring to summer of 2021 is what when they were thinking the CEQA and the public participation and the hearing process. would hopefully be in the, you know, first to second quarter of 2021. And then they also then outlined, you know, basically from there, it would be all permitted with the demolition of the buildings is all included within the permit, and then the construction of the project. And of course, the demolition would happen well before the construction of the project. But essentially, they outlined that project schedule in detail, and I just wanted to let you know that that project is moving forward.
Thank you. And other staff reports?
Sure, I have a couple of things I was going to update you on. One is has to do with Spartina densiflora, and I think as the board knows, the Harbor District has played an important role in controlling Spartina densiflora, which is a non-native grass that has invaded salt marshes here. We hold the coastal development permit and the Harbor District permit that other entities around the bay use to control Spartina. They operate under that. And we're taking a fairly large effort right now to update the GIS, the spatial database showing where Spartina is around the bay. And then we're looking at potentially also sort of updating the goals for Spartina control around the bay. Around 10 years ago, when the Harbor District really got involved in this, the goal was to eradicate it from the entire West Coast. There was a lot of funding at that time. We haven't eradicated that species, and so it's a good time to reevaluate the goals. And the first step of that is to see where we're at. So we've hired an intern who started this week and is going to help us to, you know, collect all the data from all our partner agencies on where Spartina still is and where it's been controlled, and to help start reevaluating those goals. So we're really glad to have a student from Humboldt State University, a senior, working with us on that. I have a project that we've been working on where we're going to start, and I think you'll be excited about this. We're going to start a bi-monthly Humboldt Bay speaker series. We want to have people come give talks about Humboldt Bay in a very, celebratory way about Humboldt Bay. You know, so often there's controversy around the bay, but this is just a forum for people to present about different bay topics. We're going to start it with a presentation on the history of Humboldt Bay, the history of development, and so forth, and then start going into different topics: fishing, mariculture, shipping, sea level rise, conservation, all those different types of topics. I expect it to be well attended, and really looking forward to it. And we expect we're going to have the first speaker is going to be in April. So more details on that to come soon. And
like over at the Aquatic Center?
I think it's going to be at the Aquatic Center. Right? I was initially thinking here, but I think the turnouts could be too large.
Yeah.
So that's awesome. Something that we're putting on, we're sponsoring?
Or no, there'll be no cost to the Harbor District. Mm-hmm. We'll find sponsors from other entities to rent the room and for cookies and stuff. So, yeah.
Cool.
Great. That sounds exciting.
Yeah, I think it's an exciting thing. And just for positive discussion about the bay, bring diverse entities together in that kind of forum.
Good job.
That's all I have. Yeah.
Any other staff reports?
We can't get through a meeting without my picture, so.
I was hoping for something.
Let's see here. Okay, so from the facilities team, is that the right thing? There we go. Nice little shot of our Port Authority boat out on the water. It's been busy recently. We're still working on Woodley Island here. We're replacing the wildlife fence. It's going well. It's a slow process only because we were a little short-staffed for a period of time. Recently, we relocated the storage area, and we've created a dedicated pump station. That was a recommendation from one of our marina tenants and someone that spoke to the commission here a while back, that it was something that Clean Water Marinas are doing. So a little more on that in a moment. Squatters continue to be a challenge here, both on the island and in our wildlife area particularly. Just today I actually discovered this transient trail that goes down on the west side of the road, and picked up quite a bit of trash there. And then this is a kind of a stock photo, if you will, but this is one of my my friends here on the island that frequently comes uninvited. But I think we're getting a handle on him. I think I finally found his trail today. So we'll continue to work on that. As for the marina itself, under the direction of our marina manager, Corey, and with excellent cooperation of our fishermen, we were able to relocate our storage yard, if you will. This is our work yard, and we've got everybody going back to the storage yard. So this is now available for rent for work purposes, and this is, of course, just one side of it. But great project. Corey's doing a fabulous job on that. This is a slip D23, so this is our dedicated pump station for both bilge and holding tanks. This is working very well. People can come to the desk or they can call in and say they want to be pumped. We're down there in minutes. It's also helping us to control what's going in our bilge system. Not to keep picking on this poor pilot, but as many of you know, the Humble Bay Port Authority boat, and along with a vessel team assisted with rescuing a stranded pilot from Humble Bay, I happen to be present for that, and an absolute compliment to Corey Moores. Again, Corey's our marina manager. He was completely calm, attentive. We got into about a foot of water at one point in time. We were able to drop the bow of the boat and go right up to the plane. But he was under an emergency response. He had fire personnel on board talking to him. We had Coast Guard radios going. We were doing our best to navigate. It was quite foggy. You can imagine that it was an event. And I just, again, I want to compliment Corey. That guy remained absolutely calm. Perfectly navigated that vessel up there. Those divers did not have to get wet, nor did that pilot have to come back into the water. He was able to go immediately onto the vessel and be brought inside and be warm. So it's a privilege to work with Corey. And compliments, of course, the Humble Bay Fire Rescue Team. This is Brett Banducci. I don't know the other gentleman, and the U.S. Coast Guard. It was a very well-organized event, and through a lot of the trainings that we do on a recurring basis, this had a fabulous outcome. And in teamwork and under the direction of Adam, our deputy director, we worked with him and DFW staff to work on Osprey. We have them all over Revo Marine Terminal 1 and 2. We know we lost power there the last summer, the beginning of summer last year in regard to that. So there was an assessment done of an existing nest. We installed two newly built platforms to create a proper place for them to roost. In addition to that, this is a deflector up here you can see that's installed on some newly repaired wires. We're building one additional nesting platform and then going to continue to install deflectors to deter future nesting on live wires. Finally, we have a new friend.
Can I just add something? That was absolutely also sort of coordinated with our development plans, like the NOTA project and with the agencies to make sure that it was all cleared, you know, that we're basically clearing the areas for development, but at the same time giving areas for the Osprey to roost.
And there you have it. This is a great little fella that, or maybe a little girl, that we often see when we're over at the England Marine Fuel Dock. And so how can you not resist including her in our evening tonight? We haven't named her yet. That's all I've got. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Moving on to the council report.
I have no report tonight.
And we don't have the district treasurer here, so I'll move on to commissioner reports. Commissioner Duss.
Yeah, hey, quickly, I just want to give a shout-out, thank you. The recent press release from the Corps of Engineers, very excited about the funds coming to Humble Bay and the work on the jetty that they're planning on doing, as well as the dredging. That's very, very exciting, and that's going to be, I just see lots and lots of additional benefits that aren't on their goal list that are going to hit the Harbor District's goal and help the Bay out in general. So just a thank you to the Corps of Engineers for stepping up and working those funds towards Humble Bay. Was full of committee meetings and meetings with constituents this month, and I think a few of those we'll see on agenda items later tonight, and a couple agenda items coming up in the near future too. So lots of activity around the bay and lots of interest on the bay. So
thank you.
Well, I want to follow up on what Corey said about the airplane. Harbor District staff, all of them, Corey included, but they were on the spot. They had it. It was, I know it's their job, but they did a damn good job of it. And they were professional, and you know, thank God nobody got hurt, but they did a pretty amazing job taking care of business, and we all owe them for that. So I certainly do. And I think I agree with you, Larry. I was happy to see that Corps of Engineers. I think it was a Jared Huffman statement. I think Jared, Larry, and the Dredge Committee, working with the Corps, have. I think we have a good plan. Keep our fingers crossed it all goes well. I want to give a shout out to the youngest third grader I know. His name is Clark. Saturday is his birthday. He's 2. But he's in third grade. So figure that one out. Right? I had the honor of driving around the county.
That's so cute.
Huh?
We don't believe you.
No, he's 2.
It's adorable.
Does he wear stilts?
It's a leap year thing.
Oh, it's a leap year thing. Okay.
Yeah. He's 8. But he's only 2. So we had 2 birthdays.
Thought it was cute.
Last Friday, I got to take a couple county supervisors, city, the mayor, and the Norwegian consulate around the bay for a tour, and it was pretty cool, Larry. They are very excited about this place, and it's fun to be with people that are excited about things that we're excited about. I mean, we geek out on things, but I don't even think we come close to the way they geek out on things. Sorry. Didn't mean to say that way, but wanted to apologize for missing last month's meeting. I took my wife out to dinner. I played hooky. Took my wife out to dinner.
It's her birthday.
It was her birthday. Yes, yeah. It was her birthday. And I want to say, you know, thank you to my fellow commissioners, the staff, and the public for my year as chair. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Thank you.
Now, Max? I got to meet the Norwegian consulate with the Norwegian or the Norway people and
the Norway people?
Yes. Yeah, well, the consulate, I said, well, I wanted to excuse us for the weather. And he said, we Norwegians, it's not bad weather, it's bad clothing.
Yeah.
You dress the way the weather is.
Well, it was beautiful.
And I thought that was interesting. The project for the North and South Jetty has went out for bid. The bids are going to be between $10 and $23 million. And so that's going to be quite the project, and it's going to be a very much an economic booster for Humboldt County. And in case some people that haven't heard or know yet, there's going to be a grocery store in Samoa. Does anybody care about that?
What kind of grocery store?
Murphy's Market.
Woo!
It's going to be coming into Samoa here in the next year, and of course the town of Samoa will start building out to 80 people or 80 units this next year with a secondary water treatment plant that will be using our outfall line. So it's actually a lot of things happening with the Harbor District. I don't know how you're keeping all up with everything. Larry, what's going on right now is kind of crazy.
It's good crazy.
Good things happening in Samoa. This is good. Besides perch.
Maybe one day we'll get a grocery store in Blue Lake. Commissioner Higgins.
You can only hope, Stephen. No rain has been, steelhead fishing has been really good this month. And that's a good thing. Ocean's been a little bit off for Chinook salmon production, but the sport catch and the counts that they're getting on in the eel would suggest that species are doing all right. And people that love to do it, they're crazy about it. They call it steelhead fever. And rivers have been gorgeous. You can get a tan and catch a steelhead. That's pretty rare. I had a meeting with Adam and Larry Otger and Larry Doss on sediment, but since that's on the agenda here, I'll go light on that. But I'm very optimistic about the way things are shaping in that. And you know, it's so sunny, I've been gardening. I feel kind of guilty.
but I'm building new soil, and I'm out in the garden, and I think that it's going to be a bumper crop this year. You're going to get healthy eating salads. They don't call it slow food for nothing. Do you know how long it takes to make a salad? Thank you, Stephen.
Thank you. So, yeah, I also had the opportunity to meet with the Norwegian delegation as the Consulate General in Innovation Norway came up from San Francisco along with some representations, and they came out to my work at the Blue Lake Rancheria to tour our microgrid because they're very interested in doing similar energy types of projects in conjunction with their other projects. And it was, all of them were fine in the cool weather except for one. Turns out he was the new hire for their construction manager who comes from Atlanta. So he thought it was cold. Everyone else thought it was balmy. Yeah. He was like, can we go in now? Let's see what else. And then there was the Operating Engineers Labor Union annual crab feed, which was also full of Norwegians and other people, and Commissioner Marks was there as well, and that was a great event.
And commissioners from Del Norte.
And commissioner, we got to meet some of our fellow harbor commissioners from Del Norte, that's true. Yeah, they put on a great event. I was honored to be able to go to that. And then coming up here soon, very soon on March 21st, will be the annual Perilous Plunge to benefit the Redwood Coast Discovery Museum. And there is actually a team from the Harbor District participating. Last year it was a team of one, now it's a team of two. The executive director and myself will be bravely, if we get donations, if we get sufficient donations, we'll be bravely jumping into the bay. If nobody wants to see the executive director of the Harbor District or the president of the board jump into the bay, then I guess we don't have to donate. We don't have to do it. But that will be coming up for.
I'll give you $10 if you jump. And I'll give you $20 if you die.
Last year I dove, so.
Okay, okay.
There we go. So and now we got to do it.
I know Larry will die.
Redwood Discovery Museum dot something or another, and it has all sorts of links to get to, and you can find the Harbor District team and Larry and I, and you can donate that way.
I thought there was more commissioners doing it this year. Didn't hear some great talk.
I don't know. You could remind me if we did. I don't.
I never did. I'm just shooting my mouth off.
With that, let's move on to unfinished business. And so we'll start with a report from the Double Bay Harbor District Dredge Subcommittee.
Go ahead.
Well, we have articulated plans going forward and a specific timeline. We have a strategy for getting an incidental take permit for the notorious California endangered species listed longfin smelt. And these strategies are grounded, and timeline's tangible, and that's an improvement from the past. And next on the target for getting a similar timeline would be King Salmon. And you know, these projects with dredging are so long overdue, but we have, Adam is adept at the science, and so we're providing arguments for the regulatory agencies that should meet their concerns, and we're also switching off of the cutterhead. The cutterhead looks like a science fiction monster. We really should get some science fiction footage with the cutterhead before we sell it. But then we need to get a new type of dredge that will require a lot less manpower, and I believe also because of the way it blows water down, that stirs up the sediment, that it repels fish on the outside and sucks the sediment up in the middle. Larry Otker has thought about this in depth, and if you basically run the machine to where you start it just about a foot and a half above the water, most of the time you're operating, the thing is going to be in the sediment. There's no chance we're going to be sucking up smelt. So that thing costs like a lot less than the cutter head, and so if we get anything out of the cutter head, then we'll be probably out front in terms of like being able to pick up a new piece of equipment. And if to do were as easy as just to say what would be good to do, then we'd be there already. But we've got a good plan, we've got a good staff, and we've got a good case, and it hinges on the fact that we're now taking over property by KINS that already has swarming with longfin smelt. And so if we keep people, nasty people from, no, not nasty, just opportunistic people from developing it, then that's something that Fishing Game values highly. And then they see, especially if we're enhancing that habitat, that we're doing good things for the longfin smelt. And so that should get us an ITP. And eelgrass is different, but we have a suite of arguments there that are highly persuasive and intend to prevail. Because king salmon, I mean, it's pretty crazy we haven't been able to do anything king salmon since like 2014. But I, for me, it was kind of an epiphany. I figured out kind of the mechanics of why we hadn't been going forward, and also am confident with the plan that we have that we will now be able to make progress and get into a, you know, maintenance mode where we're doing a modest amount every year, reusing it on the peninsula. That's making progress at the North Coast Regional Water Quality Control Board, and that is that they have a municipal designation for anything that isn't designated in groundwater. So then, like, they don't want us to put salt water on top of the small peninsula because it might get into the groundwater, and they have an automatic designation, even though it's brackish, nobody uses it, and there's a surplus of fresh water. So we expect to get accommodation from them relatively rapidly, although it would officially have to go into the basin plan and be a basin plan amendment. I didn't know I was going to make this report.
Do it good.
All right. Didn't I say anything, Larry? Larry?
I'll just add on to briefly, and then turn it over on the Samoa Peninsula, where we talked about basically that working with Danco to basically use our sediment material, and then we have to do testing of the sediment material to make sure that you can use it as a construction fill. And then if there's concrete, Portland cement or lime or another amendment that we have to add to it, but that you can use it for sea level rise and climate change adaptation, but actually using it as a construction fill. And so that's really is the next step that Adam is working with SHN and Danco on. And if we can do that, then we can have a place to put our material. And like you said, the Water Quality Control Board not requiring us to line the material, and therefore we don't have to take it all the way out to Hoods, 3 miles offshore, which should dramatically reduce the cost and set the stage in the long term so that we can adaptively reuse the material for construction management in addition to restoration type projects. Larry?
You both were very eloquent, and I think the one thing that I'd like just to pile on and add to it is that the district definitely has timelines, plans, and we're not hoping to do some dredging. We've got some real good action plans on the board, and I'm excited to see the rest of them come out from Adam soon, and then we'll, you know, the whole board will have them in hand and be easy to answer questions and look at dates and as well as financing plans to them too. So dredging just doesn't seem like it's a far off glimmer anymore. It looks like it's just going to be part of our regular maintenance, which is great.
And we're also going to prime the pump by talking to the city of Eureka about like how we can help them in the future, what that arrangement might look like. And it's my just kind of professional guess that when we dredge for them, we can save them a ton of money versus what they just paid to have stuff go to the Hoods, and still have that be enough over our costs to where it helps us with dredging on this site. And so I think, you know, things are shaping.
Anything else from the board? Any questions or comments?
I guess the last thing to, just to cap it off, is that we've been focused on Woodley Island, and as Pat and Larry said, and we just dredged Fields Landing, and what we all agreed to is that, you know, number one is that we need to maintain the dredging strategy for Fields Landing, because we dredge it, but we already have to be planning for that next dredging cycle. Mm-hmm. We're collecting the dredge surcharge fees, but we have to monitor it to make sure that we're keeping track of what the dredge depths are, and be prepared for the next time that we need to dredge it. And that's kind of is the whole thing of keeping on top of it before it gets out of hand, because we can't get into crisis mode. And then now that we're starting to feel like we've got a handle on Fields Landing, and with getting a better handle on Woodley Island Marina, we're still not quite there yet, but we're getting a better handle. We got to give much more attention to King Salmon, and start developing the specific strategy for how we're going to go in and tackle the eelgrass mitigation and some of the other issues that we kind of put off, so that we could focus on Fields Landing and Woodley Island Marina. But right. We certainly haven't forgotten about the King Salmon at all.
Right. And staff's already started some preliminary look into the seawall replacement repairs, which is going to be probably the low-hanging fruit, I would imagine. And then some of the elements in King Salmon, you know, once we start and break into that first run, it's not like that area needs to be dredged often. In some places there, it hasn't been touched for 30 or so years. So we just need to get back into a man's shape on that main canal first. And we have some good, we talked about some good opportunities there with restoration projects. So I think as we, you know, as a little bit more time goes, and we can talk about some of the closed session things as they become public, I think it'll make a lot of sense to the public and everyone of how the whole picture is really coming together nicely for dredging.
Well, and one of the key things is, like, we have to get the agencies, and in particular Fish and Wildlife on the longfin smelt, to say okay to the more cost-effective, less labor-intensive dredge before we can make that move. So hopefully that'll happen once we engage on the incidental take permit, so that we have time to make the transaction, so we're set up when we have the budget to dredge. So.
So I just have one question related to it. It seems like the dredging of the Army Corps needed to dredge the inner channel will make a big difference in lowering the impact on the marina. Has that been part of the conversations? I know they're coming up with the big funding for the jetty repair and all that, but what's the prognosis on getting that inner channel dredged?
I'm trying to nail that down, and I think that, you know, I can't say enough about the Army Corps of Engineer, but I think, you know, they're really waiting to get the bids for the jetty repairs, because it's a big project.
Oh, yeah.
It's a really big project, is that, you know, like you're saying, 10 to 20 some million dollars, and they've anticipated about a $20 million project, plus the additional normal dredging of the entrance channel that we have, which is another about $6 million project that they typically do, and that we requested from them, because remember when we had the emergency shoaling, we had $3 million that was budgeted to do the inner channel, which we desperately need in front of Eureka and Woodley Island Marina right here. This is the worst part of the channel, is right there, and that channel is basically most likely increasing sedimentation here, because it's just, there's no place for it to go because the channel is so shallow in this reach right here. And so the discussions that we've had is I'm trying to pin them down on the inner channel, is do you have money for the inner channel, and then can we go in and do that? And so then coupled with that, there's kind of just these other strategies that we have. And since we're on this overall dredging strategy and the Army Corps of Engineer component, the first component is this increased communication with the Army Corps of Engineers. And the colonel, and that's the military officer that's in charge of the San Francisco district, and the civilian person that's in charge of the district are coming back up here in March to the Harbor Safety Committee, because one of the key things that we did was we had the Army Corps of Engineers be a member of the officially be a member of the Harbor Safety Committee, and that way they're sitting in and they're listening from the Fishermen's Marketing Association, the Coast Guard, all the people, so that they know firsthand what's going on. And so we actively have that. The colonel and the civilian person are coming up here, and that's part of the reason why the jetty repairs, we last time they were up here, we took them out, we showed them the jetties, how bad they are. If you, when you come up and you're a part of the community and you're a part of our committees, then you have a better understanding of what's going on in our bay as opposed to being in San Francisco. And so the Army Corps of Engineer relationship is really critical towards dredging Woodley Island Marina, but also for the commercial fishermen to make sure it's safe for the passengers that they're going out, and the shipping industry, make sure that we're open and more reliable port, and with the ultimate goal of becoming a 12-month port so that we can have attract shipping and have a reliable port for our industries.
Is there a date for that March safety meeting?
The date is confirmed. I just don't know what it is off the top of my head.
It's the third Thursday? Thank you.
And it's during the daytime.
It's during the daytime.
Yeah,
right here.
9 a.m.
9 a.m.
Third Thursday. Mm-hmm. March.
It's been a long time since they dredged in here. I've been on since 2007. I haven't seen it.
Yeah, it's got to affect the ability of the Marina to scour.
And
so is there anything else from the board here?
Pat alluded to it. Definite hard discussions on putting a for sale sign on the dredge. But we don't have any formal information on the report.
And this is just a report now,
yeah.
So there's no hard action on here.
The whole bridge or just the cutter part?
That's the part that's getting evaluated.
Just curious.
Not the pipe, but you know, if we can hang on the pipe, we might part with some of it. Sorry,
I think
Greg.
It'd be, Adam and I had a conversation with the guy from the dredge here the last time.
Yeah, from Dutra?
Yeah, from Dutra. And I would suggest that that committee speak to somebody that knows about dredging instead of making stuff up yourselves, and talk to a professional, because he has a lot of it's not rocket science. They do it every day. Mm-hmm. They do it all over the country. They do it all over the West Coast, and they know what the hell they're talking about. So I would suggest getting in contact with the guy. We couldn't talk to him too much before because we had bids out, but we can't now.
I have another.
And design builds are not against the law. So I would make sure that you made that, you reached out to them, Adam. Would you set that up? Because he is definitely a sharp guy.
Yeah.
I have another person that's also heavy in dredging for 30 years that I could give you the number to that would be a wealth of knowledge for you also.
Yeah. Fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, that sounds like a good time to go to the public.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I can't help myself.
Any other public comment on this item? Okay, I'll bring it back to the board, and it is just a report, no action. I guess we can move on to item B, consider adopting resolution number 2020-04, amending the Woodley Island Marina fee schedule to increase the dredge surcharge.
So yeah, we had went to the board, we had a couple of meetings on this at the board meeting. The conclusion of the board was to basically had the subcommittee meet with tenants of the marina. We had three different meetings of the tenant, and actually it was really good discussions on this. I felt like it was really good discussions. They were honest dialogues from my perspective, which I always appreciate, and are willing to listen and learn. We basically had an open book policy. Anything they asked for, we tried to give it to them. And then if they had any questions, to try to explain it to them in as much detail. And then they provided some great insight to us. It was really a two-way learning curve from my perspective. We learned a lot from the tenant's perspective, and I think they learned a lot about what the Harbor District was trying to do. It's included in the staff report. There's basically some basic assumptions or that we've come to, that I've repeated a number of times. Basically, we think 15,000 cubic yards is accumulating approximately every year. It varies depending upon, obviously, in heavy winter events and other things, there's more. And in some years where there's not as much rainfall, there may be a little less. There's about 100,000 cubic yards of backfill, a backlog that's in the marina that we need to get out of there. And it costs about $25.50 a cubic yard plus mobilization costs to dredge. And so these are kind of the basic ground rules that we know. Now, we've went out to bid a couple of times and we know what things are. 100,000 cubic yard backfill, it's about $2.5 to $3 million project. We just don't have $2.5 or $3 million floating around here. And so we're not gonna have it anytime soon. As a matter of fact, if you look at the Woodley Island Marina, all of the slip revenues for every boat that we have in the entire marina, and the transient slips, and the dredge surcharge fees that we collect, all of that together is $800,000 a year. Again, if it costs us about $620,000 to remove about 20,000 cubic yards, we're only getting $800,000 of revenue total. We still have to pay electricity and water bills and staff and all of those other things. There's no way that the tenants can pay the entire cost of dredging. It's just, it's not feasible for them. And so then what we talked about was basically, let's try to develop a system where the goal, and these are goals that we have, to try to raise approximately 50% of the revenue would come from the dredge surcharge fees, and then about an additional, the other 50% the district would find from other places, like RMT2, tax revenues, in essence, from the district's revenues, without specifying exactly where those would come from. And so then, initially, I had proposed some alternative methods, and if we looked at these goals, ultimately the goal was to get to the point where we're raising approximately $400,000 a year, and then that way we could get into a two-year dredge cycle was kind of the goal. And if the dredge surcharge fee raised approximately $200,000, and then the Harbor District was able to find another $200,000, it was determined that we would need to increase the fee by approximately 75 cents in order to do that. We currently collect about $100,000 in revenue with the dredge surcharge fee at 76 cents. And so if the dredge surcharge fee was up to $1.51, then we would bring in approximately $200,000 of revenue. And then some of the things that we already talked about, which is to get the Army Corps of Engineers to dredge the interchannel, then that way the sediment is less likely to accumulate in the marina, and that would be less material that we would need to remove. Also, the tenants came up with the idea of really increasing the efficiency, and we should look at increasing the occupancy of the marina itself and look at the tenant mix. Because if we increase the occupancy of the marina, what happens is then we're automatically collecting additional dredge surcharge fee at the same rate as the increase in occupancy. In other words, if we're operating at, say, 80% occupancy, just as an example, and we increased our occupancy to 90%, then we would automatically be collecting an additional 10% of dredge surcharge revenues with those. And so what the committee kind of came up with is we really need to look at our tenant mix and to see what is our strategies, and then how can we, just by management perspective, increase the amount of revenues that we have. They were saying really focus on the amount of permanent tenants that we have, looking at some of the liveaboard tenants, and should we potentially be having more liveaboards than we currently have, really looking at our mix, and then seeing, is it the right mix that's, number one, meeting the needs of our tenants, but also maximizing the revenue potential that we have out of the marina. And so overall, I just really wanna thank the committee and the people that participated in that. And the recommendation that came out of the consensus of those that attended the final meeting that we had was to raise the fee 75 cents with a CPI increase just automatically built into the code. So that way we're not addressing this issue over and over again. And so the recommendation is to approve resolution 2020-04, authorizing the dredge surcharge fee increase with the CPI.
So moved.
Second.
Thank
And it's 76 cents, not 75 cents. Just so we're...
Is the increase 76 cents, or it's a 75 cent increase on 76 cents currently?
Sorry.
That is correct.
Sorry. I stand correct.
Is there any discussion from the board here? From the people who are on the subcommittee?
Larry covered it very well. It was really a good set of meetings. Really enjoyed it.
I just would like to congratulate you on doing that and being on the subcommittee, and I think it was important to have those meetings, and it sounded like it went well, at least from this perspective, to bring the community and the Marine attendants into that discussion, so I'm glad that occurred. All right, so no more discussion from the board, bringing it to the public.
Good evening, gentlemen. Vivian Hallowell. I like a lot of the things I hear tonight about your progress toward figuring out ways to dredge and make this a safer harbor entrance, and you know, the discussions you've been having with the people, and there's only one thing I hear that I really think is wrong, and that is raising the dredge fees, which you're proposing to vote on right now. Now, I think it's wrong because since the last dredging cycle, you received about over $600,000 in dredge fees that were used for something else other than dredging the slips. And therefore, the inhabitants did not receive the services that they paid for. There are other sources of money that you could develop to backfill for that transfer of funds, so to speak. For example, finishing some pre-permitting leases on the subtitle lands. Even one or two small leases would pay a considerable amount to the board, to the harbor. I don't know if you've refinanced your loan from the high interest that it went to from Pack Choice. It seems like if you haven't, that it's a very unreasonably high rate of interest to be paying while putting more burden on the fishing fleet, which is already struggling in several different ways. Now, fishermen had to be a lot of places today. There was a salmon informational meeting in Santa Rosa that some of our fishermen went to. Tonight, from 5 to 8, there was a meeting on sediment from Elk River. And it was, it's been a year since those folks have met, while their watershed steward from the Regional Water Board talked with 60 landowners about different kinds of designs that they could use in Elk River to dig side channels, for example, onto private property so that some of the mud wouldn't build up and cause the what they call nuisance flooding, which is a health and safety hazard for the people who live in the places that get flooded, about 12 families up there that can't get in and out when it rains 2 inches or less. Now, you know, we're still not talking about where the mud comes from for various reasons. There's a big plume that comes out of freshwater every time it rains, even an inch or less. It's dramatically visible in aerial photographs. Now, we sent up a drone up a few weeks ago over Elk River entrance on a high tide, and there had been less than 1 inch of rain in any day during the week previous to the photographs that we took of dark chocolate mud coming out the channel. Now, the remediations that they're planning in the lower Elk River to relieve the flooding are going to put more mud into Humboldt Bay, they say. And I'm talking about the water board. staff in their presentations. Now, we have been videoing these meetings, and the official Water Board meetings are being officially videoed now and are online. So when they give presentations about these projects, you can go and look at them. And you know, I just think it's wrong to double charge us. A lot of guys were fishing today too, so you know, other people said, why bother, come talk to these folks, they don't, you know, they're gonna vote how they're gonna vote, they're not, you know, it's a waste of our time. But I was encouraged by several people who said, glad you're going, and you know, put in a word for us. It's double charging to raise the fees on the fishermen to pay for the dredging that wasn't done with the money you got from them already. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comment from the public?
Brady Moretta, Woodley Island, Eureka, Fields Landing. I just wanted to bring to your attention an untapped source of revenue that it seems that could be a solution in a lot of different ways to what's a lot of the gripes are. You have a facility here that could host events. You could make Humboldt Bay Harbor District and Recreation Center and everything that goes on in the Humboldt Bay or pertaining to the Humboldt Bay an event, an educational thing, a forum for people to have booths that educate, a place for issues to be brought up and talked about. All the recreational aspects of Humboldt Bay could be tied into it, and you could generate revenue from this. Among some of the hats I wear, I'm an industrial worker, a commercial fisherman, historic restoration. I also spent time in the entertainment business, a long time in the entertainment business. So I understand the permitting processes, I understand the security needs, I understand the entertainment aspect of it, organizing live music, all that stuff, and putting on an event safely and profitably. Why there isn't an event, a special events coordinator amongst you all, utilizing the space that you have here, I do not know. But it could be something that could help with additional revenue beyond 50% of what you're looking for. And I just thought it should be mentioned as another possible solution. Dredge Fest 2021.
Take your own show.
Thank you.
Bring a
bucket. Yeah.
Bring a bucket.
Okay. There's no other public comment. I bring one back to the board.
Whatever.
Any additional comment here? I mean, this staff, I can say, is looking at multiple ways to bring more revenue into the district, and a lot of that is to take a lot of these revenues. As Larry mentioned, the dredge fees do not come close to covering the cost of the dredging, and so the funds that we're bringing in is to cover. We're looking for funds to cover up that additional shortfall at this point.
You know, a point to that is that we, you know, Larry brought up the cost of dredging, and that's the activity of dredging. We're in the district year-round is expending quite a bit of funds in just preparing for permits and reports and studies and whatnot, just to benefit dredging. So there's more that's being invested, I would say, throughout the whole year towards dredging that we're not accounting for on this. But we're trying to hit the big number, which is the actual cost of moving the mud.
And yeah, whether or not it seems like it from up here, I think it's everyone's goal up here and on staff to get the dredging done in as cost-effective and timely manner as possible against many, many obstacles.
It really pains me that we're raising the rates. You know, if we do hit a lower center of gravity in terms of what it costs us to operate and the revenue that we generate with our partner in the city of Eureka. I want to come back to this issue, and I'm trusting that we're looking at this in terms of like how much this increases residency and use of Woodley Island Marina, and that we're still competitive, because you know, you can't, if you raise it too far, then we fall out of being competitive as a marina, and then we'll have even bigger problems. But oh, I'm prepared to vote for this, but I can't get very excited about it.
I'd like to say something to Vivian as well. Not just Vivian, but all of course, officially, all attendants. We struggled with this the whole time. We struggled with it 8 years ago when we raised the rates before. And we've looked at comparable rates around the West. You know, you can't compare San Francisco, you can't compare Portland, but we have looked at comparable rates. We're all kind of in the same boat, all the marinas up and down the coast. One of the things that we did the last time we raised rates was we took a fairly large slip rent, and we took a dredge surcharge, and we took a dock repair surcharge increase. So you the last time tenants took three. This time you're not going to take three, you're going to take one. And then the last time we decided as a board and as a committee with tenant approval was, well, not necessarily approval, but agreement, I guess, was that we wouldn't do an annual increase. We would take a large, I think we did an 8% increase the last time. And
how many years ago did you say that was?
I think that was, it was the first year I was on the board, so it was 8 years ago. Right? And we didn't do an annual cost of living increase or a CPI increase. This time the committee and the members of that committee all suggested doing that, putting a smaller incremental annual increase instead of waiting 8 years and giving a larger increase. I know that doesn't make it any better tonight. And I certainly understand the predicament that we all are in. The bottom line is infrastructure, maintenance, and improvement is costing more and more money, and we don't have any choices. We don't have a lot of options. We are doing the best we can with our budget, and I think we have a bright future. We're just not there yet. So I appreciate your comment. And I'll leave it at that.
Okay, if there's no additional comments, we'll vote. We have a motion.
It's a resolution.
It's a resolution, so it's a roll call vote.
Commissioner Doss?
Yes.
Commissioner Dale?
Yes.
Commissioner Marks?
Yes.
Commissioner Higgins?
Yes.
And President Coleman?
Yes. Okay, resolution passes, and then we'll move on to item C, consideration of adoption of resolution 2020-03, which establishes findings relative to the application by the County of Humboldt for the Pine Hill Road over the Swain Slough Bridge replacement project.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, is there any, we're doing these one at a time, or is it one
yes.
item but two sub-items?
Both.
They can be presented at the same time, but we need to take separate votes on one and two.
Yeah.
So the second one, just so they can be presented at the same time, is consideration of granting permit 2020-01 to the County of Humboldt for the Pine Hill Road Bridge replacement over the Swain Slough Bridge.
I'll move for that adoption.
I'll second that.
Okay, do we have a report on these?
Yeah. Thank you. So this is, as you noted, consideration of the Pine Hill Road bridge replacement. First, there'll be a resolution and the permit. The board accepted this for filing a little over 30 days ago. It went out for 30-day public review. We did not receive any comments. The bridge is located where that yellow, call it diamond is, kind of in Central Bay. It's a tributary to the Elk River called Swain Slough, and it's a bridge on Pine Hill Road over Swain Slough. We'll call it the Pine Hill Road Bridge. The county is proposing to replace that bridge. The existing bridge is a three-span bridge. It's 63 feet long, 20 feet wide, built of a timber stringer structure with a concrete deck. And the county and Caltrans have found that it's structurally deficient. There's rot and cracking on the bridge. It's old and in need of replacement. That's the bridge. The main thing I want to note is, again, it's three-span, which means that there's two sets of piers in the slough, right? You can see in the top, kind of, you look close, there's two sets, and on the bottom, you can see all the piers in the slough. They're proposing to replace it with a single span bridge. It's longer, 80 foot versus, I think it's 63 foot long, 30 feet wide versus, I think, 20 feet wide. They're adding shoulders to make it safer for pedestrians and bicyclists. It would be a precast concrete single span bridge. Construction would take one season. Because it's precast, there's no need for false work. They would build a cofferdam and dewater, relocate fish out of that dewatered area before they dewater it, remove the bridge and piers. The piers would kind of be pulled down. They're concrete and then broken off below the mud line. It'd be supported by steel piles. And then, of course, there'd be sheet piles installed, too, at the edge of the water. And then, of course, they'd install the bridge on the piles. The project also includes widening of the shoulders on the approach to the bridge and relocating a water line that's currently attached to the bridge, which would be moved to under the slough through directional drilling. This table shows the elevation, the elevation of the existing proposed bridge. And it's noteworthy that the proposed bridge, the bottom of the soffit, the bottom of the bridge, is 0.4 feet lower than the existing bridge, which at face value is certainly a concern with regards to sea level rise and flooding. However, this is not something that was on notice by the county and Caltrans in this project. And there's a few points to make here. One is that even though the bottom of the bridge is slightly lower than the existing bridge, the overall capacity for water to move under it is greater because the channel will be wider and there won't be any piers in the water itself. So there's actually more volume under it. They're also designing it so that it can be raised incrementally with sea level rise without massive amounts of cost. It's being designed with that in mind. And maybe most importantly, at least from a transportation perspective, the bridge is not the limiting factor during flood events in terms of transportation. You can't get to the bridge when it's flooding. The surrounding roadways are at a lower elevation than the bridge itself. So it's not. There's much larger issues with regards to sea level rise and flooding in that area than the bridge itself. So I think Larry had a good term earlier. What did we say? Incremental sea level rise adaptation. That they're building this bridge so it can adapt. They're not solving all the problems with regards to sea level rise throughout the Elk River slough area.
Is this county or Caltrans?
Well, it's county, but it's like the local. Caltrans is involved too. What did they call it? The Caltrans assistance program. So there's funding through Caltrans, but it's implemented by the county. So it's sort of a joint effort. It's a county.
A lot of this money actually came from federal stimulus and fees through.
Caltrans signs off on it as well as the county. For this project, for a lot of the permits we issue, we go through and we add a bunch of conditions and spend a lot of time thinking about what types of conditions to add. In this case, the project came to us with a natural environment study and a bunch of documentation already showing what they intend to do with regards to minimizing and mitigating biological and other environmental effects. So the way we wrote the permit was to incorporate by reference those other documents to make sure that those conditions are already incorporated. If we start adding our own conditions and maybe the language is slightly different, then we can make it really complicated for the applicant to try to meet these slightly nuanced things. So when we went through, we saw that, you know, they're already meeting the types of conditions we put on them with regard to biology, cultural resources, air quality, and so forth. And so that's the way we wrote the permit, to incorporate by reference those other conditions. Just if some notes, again, in terms of biology, it's a full span bridge. So we're really for that. You know, removing fill, removing structure from within the slough is just a good thing, biologically, hydraulically, and so forth. They have sort of typical measures to prevent impacts to fish in terms of work windows to avoid prime times when fish would be there. They are having some impacts on Lingby sedge, which is CNPS listed plant species, and also riparian habitat. They have a good plan to mitigate for that at a one-to-one ratio through planting and control of Spartina, the non-native species, avoiding impacts to nesting birds, erosion control, measures to prevent spills of hazardous materials, air quality, dust control, and cultural resource surveys.
Recommends our two-step process that's required to approve these permits. First, to adopt the resolution
establishing findings relative to the application by the county for the bridge replacement project, and then after that, and granting the permit to the county.
I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
Very thorough.
Questions from the board?
I have a comment. It seems semi ridiculous that they don't just raise it another foot or 18 inches while they're doing it. It's going to save a lot more money. But
well, the county's not here. I've talked to him about that a little. So I will. I mean,
by doing that,
you have to also lengthen the approaches to it. And that means impacting more wetlands, more Lingby sedge, more mitigation, more costs. Now, so I mean, it's just a lot of factors to consider.
Is there eel grass underneath the bridge?
There's what I saw when I went there is there's eel grass, like dead eel grass rack. I don't see living eel grass under the bridge itself. But again, they're not putting anything new in the slough. They're only taking things out of it. So.
Yes, and there must be mitigation.
The eel grass probably grows around the pipe. But
although it is great to take care of that pipe.
Flooding comes from the other direction.
Both directions. I mean, the worst flooding is going to be
at a key tide with.
Anything from the public on because we can take comments on either of these items? Okay, seeing none, we'll vote on the resolution first.
Commissioner Doss?
Yes.
Commissioner Dale?
Yes.
Commissioner Marks?
Aye.
Commissioner Higgins?
Right on.
And President Coleman?
Sure.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, why not? Is that a legal vote?
Yes.
Sure. And I'm a yes as well. Okay, and then moving on to item two, consideration of granting permit 2020-01 to the County of Humboldt for the Pine Hill Road Bridge Replacement over Swain Street Bridge Replacement Project. We already have a motion and a second.
Yes.
So all in favor?
Sorry.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed or abstaining? So the permit passed as well.
I like the little bell. We need that bell when it's like time to vote.
Ding ding. Don't we have like fancy like
wake
story,
up
like press time
to vote?
Yeah. I will say out of permitting by what you call it?
Oh, by reference?
By reference. And not having to change things, making things less complicated.
Yeah.
I mean, are we the only agency that does that? Because
no.
It certainly does not appear that way.
No, I've never seen that.
Don't worry, it's us. Go to the Coastal Commission.
That's all right.
Yeah, okay, I'll shut up.
The Harbor District's leading the way.
No, it's not. No, yeah, it's a good thing.
It's a good thing.
It is, and I commend you for it.
We made sure they're doing what they should do, but not trying to make things harder. Because it's a big problem in permitting when you have all those slightly nuanced.
It's called pilot law, is that what you're calling it?
This is good. We hope others catch it out.
Well, and the cost depends on like how much money is put into the permitting compared to how much money is actually put into replacing the bridge.
Yeah.
And the permitting is important and making sure, I'm all in favor of like doing the environmentally and cultural and everything sound thing. But, we'll move on to new business. Item A, discuss, review, and authorize the executive director to execute the Samoa Peninsula Infrastructure Work Group Agreement. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so we've been meeting the County of Humboldt, the Harbor District, the Redwood Coast Energy Authority, the Humboldt Bay Municipal Water District, City of Eureka, and City of Arcata. We've been meeting together, to try to look at the infrastructure. Ultimately, kind of the issue is that each agency has certain responsibilities that they have, and it's not one agency that you would go to look at the infrastructure on the small peninsula.
Yeah.
So we all have our part, and it's kind of important that we coordinate together. And so what we've been looking at is basically how do we coordinate and prioritize the infrastructure? And when we look at this, there's basically the time to vote.
Yes.
There's the industrial water line, the ocean outfall pipes, saltwater intake, multi-purpose dock, right-of-way utility acquisitions, sewer main lines, water distribution lines. All of these different components, including coastal dependent industrial pre-permitting, 12-month dredging strategy, jetting reconstruction, navigation of the channels, all these issues that we've looked at, and they're all disjointed and not coordinated out there. And so there's sort of this master plan that's taking shape. If you look at the right, there's the Town of Samoa's master plan, a brand new business park, residential housing going on out there. And so that master plan was approved all the way through the Coastal Commission. On the right, you kind of see the Nordic Aqua Farms project and how their development will lay out. What we're looking at doing is basically merging the two and then looking at the infrastructure and how that may work. As we mentioned, 20 million jetty reconstruction, dredging the federal channels. These are things that are taking shape and that we're doing now. And so there's a plan that's in place, and we're looking to bridge the gaps on this. This isn't something that we're thinking about. It's not something that we're talking about. This is something that is in progress right now. And so with the Town of Samoa, there's a brand new wastewater treatment plant that is set to be built, new water tank, water lines, sewer lines, gas lines, new light industrial park, and coastal development industrial lands that are right adjacent to the Harbor District's property. If you look down on the bottom, that's sort of the old infrastructure maps. Old, disjointed, some of them are falling, leaking like a sieve. The water tank, you turn the water on, and it's just leaking. It's really, really bad shape. And so the Town of Samoa, in the next couple of years, will have brand new infrastructure. So as we mentioned, the new wastewater treatment plant, it's slated to be operating by November of 2020. The water board is, they've already released and noticed the agenda item, and all of the conditions and everything are laid out in the permit. There's the pipeline route, which would be discharged out the Harbor District's ocean outfall pipe. So in April, it should be permitted by the Water Board. Then there's already an environmental impact report for the entire Samoa Peninsula that's been drafted and circulated to all of the different agencies. And the environmental impact report was funded by the Water Board, and the Water Board would fund all of the improvements for all of the mainline and the wastewater treatment plant extension. The environmental impact report includes the main lines and all the laterals to the property. We need to get that project, that environmental impact report finalized by the county and approved. The right-of-way easements, it's disjointed. As when you go on Vance Avenue, as you're going to the mill, the Harbor District has all the right-of-way to go in there, but between the wastewater treatment plant and the ocean outfall, it's not public utilities. And so there's still the right-of-way and public utilities that need to be acquired in order to have all of these sewer main lines and sewer water lines and fire lines, because historically, those were all privately owned by the lumber mills. And so the Humboldt Bay Municipal Water District, they need about $1.2 million in order to do the upgrades just to get the water line operating so that the Nordic Aqua Farms and other people can use it reliably and in the future. Our ocean outfall pipe, included within the environmental impact report, these are the projected users that we have. DG Fairhaven already has a permit for up to 350,000 gallons a day discharge. The wastewater treatment plant at phase two, and the Nordic Aqua Farms, et cetera, approximately 9 million gallons a day that would be discharged out the ocean outfall pipe that we're projecting. So the dredge material reuse, looking at sea level rise adaptation, basically dredging out of the inner channel, about 600,000 cubic yards of material gets removed by the Army Corps of Engineers, which is basically sand that's coming down the Eel, out the Eel River, down the South Jetty, and gets deposited into the entrance channel, clean sediment. You know, 600,000 cubic yards of material, that equals about 90 football fields a year, 6 foot deep. The 6 foot deep is basically the maximum sea level rise projections through 2100 would be 6 foot. And so every year, 90 football fields, 6 foot deep of sandy material, which is basically the same things the small peninsula is comprised of, as gets hauled out to the hoods 3 miles offshore. And so the Port of Humboldt, we have potential for development. Historically, all this land was developed. We have a 7 acre dock. Redwood Marine Terminal 2 is also 1,100 linear foot dock, 168 acres of CDI lands and upland waste warehousing and office space and et cetera. We've been working really hard to do our pre-permitting of aquaculture sites, where we have 4 leases executed and additional 3 that are pending in the sites 1, 2, 3 that are all pre-permitted. What we're seeing is that these aquaculture sites, they need upland area as well as the land-based areas. And so as we're developing the pre-permitted sites that are in the water, it's also creating economic activity within the upland portions as well. And so the Nordic Aquaculture site, again, there's the site plans that are included in their application materials, up to 600,000 square feet, 400 million investment, hatchery, processing, wastewater water treatment, all of those things included in the project. And again, the application phase is in preliminary review, and anticipate the CEQA, the environmental review process, beginning this summer, fall. The wood chip industry is critically important, where we have the chip export facility, but also the biomass plant. And there's the capacity for additional wood pellet manufacturing out there in the small peninsula. We're sort of primed for new wood pellet manufacturing, either at the DG Fairhaven or someplace either in the Fairhaven area or someplace on the Samoa Peninsula of that happening. Also with the biomass plants, it's really important for potentially an energy island that could benefit the industries and have a reliable source of power. So if PG&E outages go in, they could tap into the DG power plant that's right there in order to keep us energy resilient as climate change happens in the future. And you have a cheaper, reliable source of energy for the tenants out there. Broadband infrastructure, it's happening down Highway 299, $47 million of grant funding from the California Public Utilities Commission to provide broadband services to the low-income and underserved areas along the 299 corridor. All the smaller communities along 299, they would have broadband services. That will be coming to Arcata, Eureka, and down the Samoa Peninsula, all the way into the Samoa Peninsula. There's lots of opportunity for broadband data centers and other things into the Eureka, Arcata, and Samoa Peninsula areas. Again, the offshore wind energy, 30 miles right offshore of Humboldt Bay. Humboldt is really unique in this situation because our bay doesn't have any bridges, we're a deep water port, and plus we have a significant amount of vacant industrial land that other ports don't have. The wind energy turbines, as you can see by the picture there on the left, those are about 600 feet tall. You can't get those underneath the Golden Gate Bridge, it's too tall. When they would go out the bay, they would go out fully upright, just as you're seeing here. And they couldn't go through San Diego Coronado Bridge. You couldn't go through the Golden Gate Bridge. You can't go through Coos Bay. And so Humboldt Bay is uniquely situated because not only do we have the call area right off of our coast, we also have no obstructions, deep water port, and lots of vacant industrial land available to do this. There's a number of reports that show up to 14,000 direct construction and operational jobs in the state of California, $20 to $50 billion of industry, and it's shown that they need port infrastructure, and that is a known commodity no matter where you go. They have to invest in port infrastructure. And so there's a number of different reports. The California Jobs Project, BOEM has done reports, and they're all out there. So we were looking at doing a new multi-purpose dock down at our Redwood Reed Terminal 1 property associated with the coastal dependent industrial properties that are right below the town of Samoa. You know, how an assembly area might look. And then this is just to show other port that are just specifically focused on wind energy. A brand new dock was recently constructed in New Bedford, Massachusetts. The Port of Brest, France is in the process. Portugal is building a wind energy port, and the Port of Ustad, Belgium. These are new ports, new investment. The Port of Virginia that was just put out within the last month, they signed a deal, $13 million deal. The industry would come in, do $20 million investment in crane and other port improvements, specifically for the wind energy. So the new modern dock, again, looking at RMT2, this is the dock. There was an environmental impact report specifically to build that exact same dock right there. That was done in the 1990s. We've looked at that environmental impact report. It needs to be updated, but that exact dock is what is being looked at for Redwood Marine Terminal 1. Within this is the Port of New Bedford, Maine. You can see the dock is under construction. How they constructed that was in 2014, specifically how they would remove the piles in RMT1 and how the construction took place. And then this is the port in 2015, the recent New Bedford, Maine, and you can see they're just starting to stack some of the components to support the offshore wind energy right there in 2015. This is somewhat what we're talking about here. And then this is a recent conceptual drawing that was just submitted to the Governor's Office of Economic Development for the Redwood Marine Terminal 1 that shows how it might look like if we were to do such a project on RMT1. So growing the wind energy economic cluster, it really kind of looked at what do we want to do? Do we want to become an assembly port? Do we want to do some fabrication there? Do we want to become a regional hub? The one concept is that if we build offshore wind energy and we support the wind energy off of Humboldt, then we have the infrastructure developed here. Then they can construct the wind turbines in Humboldt, and then they can tow them down to the central coast off of the Diablo Nuclear Canyon and Morro Bay. And then in the future, as other areas open up off of Coos Bay and the other areas, they could be built and manufactured in Humboldt Bay and then transported out to those areas, which are approximately 300 nautical miles away. So when we look at the timeline for the offshore wind energy kind of on the top, we look at like the projection if BOEM were to release the lease in approximately February of 2021, then they would do about a 3-year environmental review process where they're looking at whales, birds, all the other different components as part of the environmental review. And then they would need the port infrastructure in the 2024-2025 region. And so our challenge as a community is, can we get the port ready to be developed in time when the industry needs it? It takes a long time to get that. And so then we're looking at sort of in the ideal world, we would begin to do the technical studies on the wetland delineations for the upland, the geotechnical work, the eelgrass surveys, the benthic invertebrate surveys, the other things over the next year, and then begin the environmental review process and the EIR process so that we could get the permits in approximately the end of 2022 so that we could begin to initiate and be ready for the construction time period in order to operate within the industry's timeframes. And so, of course, there's operation and maintenance jobs once the facility is updated. for good-paying jobs that are designed to address climate change and give us energy resilience. And so, of course, if we're looking at Redwood Marine Terminal 1, we have to do items that are going to help the commercial fisheries because there's crab pot storage and other things. And so this is just an example of some possible improvements to Woodley Island Marina that I had presented before. But we have to address the commercial fishermen storage and provide upgraded facilities for the commercial fishermen, which would have impacts associated with the offshore wind to make sure that they're strong. And so the Schatz Energy Lab had a $750,000 study. The $750,000 study is almost coming to conclusion, and they've already scheduled the public meeting where they're going to display that one-day long meeting. That would be at the City of Eureka's facility over here. I always get the name wrong. At the Warfinger Building. And so basically within there, they looked at the grid loading, et cetera. And within number four is really where they focused on the port infrastructure. Within the port infrastructure, they hired Mott MacDonald, which is the world-class engineering firm that specializes in dock infrastructure. And they specifically are evaluating the port of Humboldt Bay and Redwood Marine Terminal 1 specifically as the capacities to do the wind energy port in Humboldt Bay. And these are the tasks that they were identified with doing. And you'll see that they will provide us with high level cost estimates to upgrade the facilities and looking at the amenities to address sea level rise and other items. And so kind of the goals that we've been discussing is how do we continue the progress that's already made with the $750,000 study. We've been meeting with, I have a meeting tomorrow morning with Redwood Coast Energy Labs, the Schatz Energy Lab, and I met today with the County of Humboldt, the CAO's office, and their economic development staff. How do we keep the momentum going, and how do we get these studies funded to address these sorts of needs? And so we applied for a Headwaters grant, and the Headwaters grant was very, very supportive of this. We asked for 3 years of $65,000 funding. It was unanimously recommended that they provide $65,000. They didn't provide the other funding because they said that wasn't on their agenda at this point. They strongly encouraged us to reapply as early as July for the additional funds. One comment that was received, they felt like the project that the Harbor District was proposing had more economic development potential than all of the other projects that they funded with Headwaters Fund since the beginning of the Headwaters Fund. And so with the application for the $65,000, we included a $50,000 commitment of Harbor District funds, which obviously I need to get the board's approval before we expended any dollars or signed any grant agreements onto that. And so we met with the county to see are there ways that we can get additional money to get this started. And then we're looking at recently the Economic Development Administration last week just released a notice of funding availability, and one specific island item that is in there is this EDA Blue Economy, which is specifically how do you get ocean jobs that are derived from the ocean's economy and the offshore wind energy of creating an economic cluster. A wind energy cluster is one of the specific items that is listed in the economic development grant application for up to $600,000 grant to pursue the possibilities to move this thing forward. And so what we're looking to do within this, one of the ideas is, this is last year the California MARAD infrastructure grant, and you can see that Port Humane, Long Beach, Oakland, and Stockton all applied for these grants specifically for port infrastructure. You can see they applied for $53 million, $16 million, $18 million, and $18 million. Two of these grants, I can't remember exactly which two were funded, but two of those grants were funded by MARAD. And the issue is beginning to prepare ourselves for the MARAD grant, if that's what the board and the community wants us to proceed with, and to get with the project readiness. And so just sort of in conclusion, we were looking at this and saying, you know, where does your tax dollar go if you you pay property taxes and there's 1% property tax on future growth? Where does it go? Schools get 62 cents of every dollar. The county general fund gets 16 cents. The county roads is 2.2. The harbor district is in the mix in this 7.5%, along with all the other special districts that are in the area. So if you, I just did this quickly. If you looked at the Redwood Marine Terminal 1, we currently have an assessed value of about $4 million in the near term. If we could increase the assessed value with other customers and the town of Samoa with their projects, the Nordic Aqua Farms and other industries, you know, if you just looked at the Nordic Aqua Farms alone, they're saying $400 million investment, even if it's $200 million. Investment, that would equate to an annual, just the county general fund portion, that 16 cents of $322,000 a year of tax revenue, and then additional $44,000 would go to the county roads department. And so then the question that we were discussing as part of these group of jurisdictions is it possible to develop a system where the county could reinvest some of the future growth in property taxes as these properties begin to develop. And again, if we get the Nordic project and we get some of these other projects going, there's an additional $547,000 a year that would come from just the projects that I described, plus an additional $74,000 that would go to the county roads department. And those are just the funds that would be derived from the projects that we kind of talked about there within the economic development potential. And so these are some of the things that we're working on within this working group. And so the Humboldt Bay Water District already executed this agreement. The County of Humboldt is the one that they directed staff to basically work to form this agreement. And so I'm asking the board to authorize me to sign this agreement, basically just saying that we're participating in this work group.
I'd like to move that we authorize the executive director to execute the Samoa Peninsula Infrastructure Work Group agreement.
Could you give an overview again on that whole scenario?
Were you breathing through your eyelids or what? I mean, my God. Never took a breath the whole time.
I wanted to do it quick. I'm trying to do it quick. These are all the projects that the Harbor District has been working on for years. This isn't something that we just dreamed up. This is something that the Harbor District Board has been working on for years, and the county and everybody. And so it's really as we're trying to put it all together in one package to try to take advantage of this. So there's a lot going on, and there's a lot of great opportunities.
Okay, take a breath.
One second. Yeah. Okay, so we have a motion and a second. Any discussion or questions from the board?
That was awesome, right?
Yeah, that was. I mean, that was a much more thorough report than I was. Excuse me.
Who seconded that?
Richard seconded.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
I mean, that touched on so many different things. I know, like, any grant agreements that'll come to us later with potential matches, and we can talk about what the match source would be, and that doesn't necessarily mean that it's coming out of Harbor District direct funds and all that, so that could be a discussion for somewhere else. But and that this is, you know, this isn't any of our funding. This is the county is putting this committee together, and we're just saying that we'll participate in this committee. So I think it's an excellent idea. Do we have any comments from the public? Then bringing it back to the board, we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed or abstaining? Hearing none. Sounds like the motion passes. Moving on to item B of new business. Consideration of resolution 2020-02, a resolution designating business matters, appointment, and authorization for the Humboldt Bay Harbor Recreation Conservation District for calendar year 2020.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second. And so this is basically our meeting calendar. And anything else in here that we should
There's actually two actions, I guess, that you should take is the, and the first one is obviously what it says here is, which is to adopt the resolution 2020-02, doing the business matters. But it included within this, there's the calendar that we're asking you to basically cancel the November and the December meetings because those fall on Thanksgiving and Christmas.
Thank you. And I still, and I know I was asking you about this before the meeting, but still have the question with the November and December meetings. If we're setting the dates now to not fall on the holidays, do they need to be special meetings or can we just call those regular meetings because we're setting the dates now?
Well, the regular meetings are set by ordinance.
And so that could only be changed by a new ordinance?
Yeah.
And so those have to be special meetings?
I mean, we can still put out agendas 72 hours in advance and treat them as if they're regular meetings, but they would be special set meetings.
And so the only thing, we can't pass ordinances on special meetings, so for those 2 months we can make is that correct? Or are we limited to what we can't do? Are there items that we can't, actions we can't take in special meetings?
There are certain items that can't be done. For example, an ordinance has to be passed at a regular meeting. But for the most part, any other action, so long as it's agendized, can be taken as special meeting.
Okay. And I know we have like somewhere on a future agenda the idea of like cleaning up some of these ordinances and stuff. So something on, you know, if there's nothing else going on. So that's all the questions I had. I guess they'll have to be special meetings in November and December. At least we're setting them now, so we don't have to be setting special meetings. Any other discussion? Any comments from the public on our calendar?
Commissioner Doss?
Yes.
Commissioner Dale?
Yes.
Commissioner Marks?
Yes.
Commissioner Higgins?
Yes.
And President Coleman?
Yes.
And then to modify the agenda, could I just get a motion in a second? Cancel the November and December meeting and to schedule the November
meeting. I move that we modify the agenda to cancel the November and December meetings from 11/26 and 12/24 and move them to 11/12 and 12/10.
Okay, we have a motion and second. Any discussion? Anyone from the public?
I'd just like to thank again the staff and the and Corey for the excellent work that he's done around here. I just, you know, my time, I noticed a big difference in the experience.
Thank you. On behalf of the staff, thank you. bring it back to the board. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed or abstaining? Hearing none, the motion passes. Any administrative or emergency permits?
There's not.
Then may adjourn.